Our next speaker is Professor Dennis Nixon, the Rhode Island Sea Grant Director from the Graduate School of Oceanography, University of Rhode Island. His title is Finding Green Solutions for the Disposal of Fiberglass Boats. Professor of Marine Affairs Dennis Nixon has served as the director of the Rhode Island Sea Grant Program since July 2013. In that role, he leads a multi-million dollar research and education program devoted to using scientific knowledge to improve the management of Rhode Island's coastal waters. Prior to that, he served as the Associate Dean for Research and Administration at the Graduate School of Oceanography at URI, and also as Associate Dean of Academic Affairs at the College of the Environment and Life Sciences, also at the University of Rhode Island. He's been a faculty member at the university for the past 38 years, teaching courses in the areas of marine and coastal law. He is particularly proud of the thousands of former students now working in marine industries, government, law, and science. And I'm waiting at some point for him to suggest that I was one of his students. a marine lawyer by training, he is a member of the Maritime Law Association of the United States and the Rhode Island Bar. He is the secretary and general counsel for the Point Club, a fishing vessel insurance cooperative he helped found over 20 years ago. He is one of the three founders of the International Mariner Institute, which provides educational programs and certification for professionals in the marine industry around the world. He's also the legal advisor and risk manager for the University National Oceanographic Laboratory System, UNALS, and has been providing advice to all of the U.S. academic research vessel fleet for the past 27 years. He's lectured on marine law topics in 27 states and 26 countries on 6 continents. He is the author of over 50 articles and the case book Marine and Coastal Law, first published in 1994 and released in the second edition in 2010. Professor Nixon earned his bachelor's degree in history at Xavier University, his law degree at the University of Cincinnati, a master's of marine affairs at the University of Rhode Island, a certificate on international institutions at the University of Geneva, and a certificate in ocean law from Harvard Law School. He is an avid sailor on vessels of all sizes and races his own boat weekly on Narragansett Bay. Professor Nixon.
Which one advances? This one? Okay. Great, thank you. Well, thank you very much, Bruce, and thank you very much for appointing me Sea Grant Director 2.5 years ago, because it has been a job I've enjoyed very much. The Sea Grant Network, Rhode Island Sea Grant is one of 33 state programs. We have about $70, $80 million a year federally, matched by 50% of that by the states that are participating. We're involved in research, education, outreach activities. It was the Sea Grant system that pioneered the concept of clean marinas that are now have been taken up by state marine trades associations supported by the Environmental Protection Agency. When I became the Sea Grant Director, I did one of those stakeholder listening tours, and as I visited all of the marine industries along the waterfront, the overwhelming comment I got from both boat yards and boat manufacturers was, you got to figure out some way to get rid of these old boats, these derelict vessels that populate every boatyard and marina. I live in that island right across here, Jamestown, where it seems like it's a zoning regulation that everyone must have a derelict boat in their backyard. The representative, Greg Dolan from the Methanol Institute yesterday, are you here, Greg, today? I was having coffee with Greg yesterday, and he mentioned that his father lived over in Jamestown, and funny thing about his dad, he had a 26-foot sailboat he couldn't get rid of, so he made it a flower planter in his backyard, and I knew that because he was my neighbor. The two techniques you see for boat disposal, one, dropping it at a dumpster. This is Florida. This is very creative. And this is a slash buster, which is a tool that's used to clear a brush alongside of a highway, this time being used to eat a fiberglass boat. all this stuff is flying fiberglass, which, by the way, has a good resemblance to flying asbestos. So it's not exactly a safe environmental practice. The irony here is that boatyards today are under an enormous amount of pressure to be environmentally clean. The yard where I keep my boat, I have to keep track every spring of every can I open because of the volatile organic components. And so they need to know if I've used 3 cans of varnish and 1 can of paint because it counts against their total that EPA allows them to emit into the atmosphere. I cannot sand my bottom without wearing full personal protective gear, a vacuum, and a cloth on the ground underneath me to catch any tiny bits of sediment that come off the hull. And yet, we are dumping entire boats in dumpsters. There's a fairly major disconnect here between best environmental practices and how we take care of boats in our marinas. The fact that we've got a couple of major sailing groups here, Sailors for the Sea, 11th Hour, helping to sponsor this this event, concerned about a single plastic bottle being thrown over the side. And yet, we're throwing these things in dumpsters. And worse yet, in many states, and I think Florida probably is the best example, or worst example, if you will, Peter, of a state in which boats are simply abandoned in all the canals. There isn't a canal you can find in Florida that's open to the intercoastal or the sea that doesn't have an abandoned boat there. In Washington, the state of Washington, many small abandoned fishing vessels, the owners have gotten quite clever at filing off the serial numbers and simply anchoring them in a harbor. When they begin to sink, the harbor master is called, and it becomes a state responsibility to rescue the boat before it becomes an environmental hazard and begins leaking its fuel. So it's a problem that we've been pushing aside for some time. I'll try it. Oh, and by the way, we have a very large boat building industry still in Rhode Island, home of Nathaniel Harishoff, the Wizard of Bristol, big boat building industry, and Randy Borges, who runs the biggest of the big at U.S. Watercraft up in Warren, Rhode Island. I took a tour of Randy's plant, and he pointed to a dumpster on the shop floor that he said, I fill this every week with virgin fiberglass scrap. As we cut boats out of the mold, as you're trimming off pieces, he said, this is beautiful fiberglass. Look at this. Finest quality you can buy. And we send this dumpster, he said, with pain and at financial cost, to the landfill every week. And he said, we must do something better. So I said, yeah, we really should. How hard can it be? Well, if it was easy, somebody would have thought of this solution some time back. At Green Boats 2, a Coast Guard student I was supporting in his master's program in ocean engineering, detailed for some of you who were there, some of the technical issues involved in the use of pyrolysis, in how you can grind up fiberglass. It can be used in molded, for example, trash can containers and so on. And yet, for some reason, despite people writing about this for 20 years, there is not an active boat recycling program going on in the country. How is it taken care of today? Well, in Rhode Island, you can no longer take a boat to our landfill. Rhode Island is most like Europe in one sense. We have one landfill. It is designed to be filled in 21 more years. We have no plan B. Incinerators are not popular in the United States. We don't have one here. And we don't have any plan. There's no discussion in place. They have said no more boats. So if you're a boatyard owner and you've got a boat you want to get rid of, the technique, which is not written down anywhere, but everyone seems to know, you just run it over a few times with some yard-heavy equipment, and then it becomes associated marine debris. Marine debris that fits into dumpsters can be taken to the landfill. But that's a stupid use of a very scarce resource. This is in Florida, where apparently you can still take entire boats to the landfills there because Florida has a lot more space than Rhode Island does. So in the course of this presentation, we'll look at where boat recycling is going on in the world, and perhaps a path is becoming clear for how we can get to this in the United States. So why is this a growing dilemma? It's a growing dilemma because the first major line of fiberglass boats was created in Rhode Island in the 1960s from Pearson Yachts. The Pearson Triton, the first common 30-odd-foot boat that went into mass production as we transitioned from wood to fiberglass. We never had a problem with disposing of old wooden boats. They rot away. We have a few of those in some backyards still, too, but they're nicely becoming part of the soil. They do deteriorate. Fiberglass boats will not, however. They retain, if not their structural integrity for going to sea, they retain their shape in a backyard forever. So we just keep building more every year, and we've not yet figured out a way to get rid of the old ones. There is no method in the United States. So we're building more boats every year, and we're also building more things out of fiberglass every year. It turns out we have a lot in common with fiberglass bathtub manufacturers and shower stall makers. When construction debris comes out of a house, those large fiberglass parts also go into the landfill where they never will deteriorate either. So this is becoming the kind of issue that is problematic, and we're seeing, because of some storm events, Hurricane Sandy, Margaret Podlich, who's the president of Boat US, real smart woman who understands she's got a problem she doesn't quite know what to do with, says she's got tens of thousands of boats that she totaled after Hurricane Sandy that are basically piled up in New Jersey. They used to be able to send their old boats to Pennsylvania, and Pennsylvania said, we're tired of you filling up our landfills with boats. Figure out some better use. So we have, after each storm event, enormous numbers of hulls that are really just piled up in a field. And there has to be a more systematic way of getting rid of them. So 2 years ago, we sponsored research on what the best ways were, whether physical process through grinding, separation of what can be recycled here. There's certainly, as you tear a boat apart, and that's that can be a dirty process, and it's why in France, for example, they have 52 official government boat dismantling centers because they recognize the worker safety issues are pretty intense. If you want to see something that's funny but disturbing, go to YouTube and just put in boat dismantling. Because every sort of rube scientist out there has figured out ways to use a sawzall or a chainsaw or some other mechanism, and there's great photos of boats falling on people and flipping off of trailers, and it's pretty dangerous stuff. But we do know that you can, there's a company called Echo Wolf in Florida that has a grinding system available, various sizes, to grind up big hunks of fiberglass into any size fiberglass you want. The problem is, what do you do with it then? With the price of oil having plummeted, any value that ground up fiberglass had has basically gone away. Because, as you can understand, it's not a pure commodity. We've got bottom paint mixed into it. There are any number of different cores that are in a fiberglass boat. Some have balsa, some have vinyl. There are various plastics instead. So it's not a completely pure commodity we're talking about here, as opposed to what you can buy very cheaply for virgin fiberglass components. There are some valuable things. In Japan, where they've recycled over 6,000 former fishing vessels, they're using pyrolysis, and they're getting basically valuable industrial liquids, liquid resins that can be reused or burned in industrial processes. The boat digest program from the European boating industry has mostly focused the world's attention on this, and there was the first boat recycling conference held in November 2015. I was hoping to attend that, but I had a little medical problem prevented me from going. The issue in Europe, it's really kind of interesting. They decided in the European Union a long time ago that landfills were a stupid use of precious space, and they either reuse or recycle or compost or finally incinerate their waste. And so waste incinerators are the most common form of final waste elimination in Europe. And today, most are waste to energy incinerators. And that's certainly how France is burning its ground-up fiberglass hulls. In Germany, the ground-up fiberglass is used to fire cement kilns. You know, when you make cement, you're basically burning limestone. You're getting a big fire going. It's good for that. The problem in the United States with incinerators is, in large part, when you think about sending a boat through, who has seen a fiberglass boat burn? Anybody seen a fiberglass boat burn? Is it a pretty sight, Joe? Yeah, it's black, toxic smoke. It's the worst thing you can imagine. It emits all sorts of terrible chemicals. So your first reaction to burning this stuff is, oh my God, that'd be a terrible idea. But that's burning, that's not incinerating, which is a very different process, which breaks those chemical components down to the bare elements, and if it's done correctly, does not have stack gas emissions, which are going to ruin the countryside. So one of our objectives this summer as we continue is, where's Evan in the room? Evan's all the way in back. Evan's my grad student helping with this. Hopefully we're sending... This is a send Evan to France thing this summer. We're crowdfunding him, because I want Evan to figure out how the European Union, which has their own set of very vigorous air quality regulations, is handling the problem of burning thousands of fiberglass boats and not creating a legal problem for them within the European Union. It's not as transparent as the U.S. government system. So we've actually got to send him over to the land of good wine and cheese and a baguette for your research this summer, Evan. But this is something we got to do for the sake of knowledge. Okay. As I said, I was surprised to learn that the Japanese really have recycled more hulls than anybody else. And this is a function as well. If you've been to Japan, they don't have any room for landfills. Any level piece of land either has a farm on it or a residence. So the idea of piling up your junk is ridiculous in Japan, and they have pioneered the most expensive way, pyrolysis. You're basically using a microwave without oxygen to reduce fiberglass to its constituent elements. It's expensive, but it's very effective. There will be another Yacht Recycling Conference, and I'm hoping that at the National Sea Grant Week, which we're hosting in Newport this fall as part of our 50th anniversary of National Sea Grant, we'll have a focus on boat recycling and try to get some interest in this nationally and perhaps run a U.S. conference on boat recycling as part of that week. So we can learn a lot from what they're doing in Europe, and we plan to duplicated that as much as possible. They're actually, as part of this conference on yacht recycling, they have developed a set of operational rules for people to guide worker safety, which is a real substantial issue when you're talking about tearing apart boats with sawzalls. Creating that market. Once we get to the point where we have an alternative, where people can take their boats to be ground up, and I think that's the most likely thing here in the United States as opposed to pyrolysis, we need to cultivate some options for how we reuse this stuff. We know that fiberglass insulation is a part of many homeowners' lives, and there is no reason why this could not be encapsulated in a way combined with other fiberglass insulation products if there were the appropriate, probably, tax incentive to do so on the part of fiberglass insulation manufacturers, incorporate some recycled content into their virgin fiberglass insulation. There is also the potential for blending ground fiberglass into molded plastic products, as I said before, like the large, heavy trash can holders you'll see in public parks or maybe in a marina. Maybe marinas could be encouraged as part of their effort towards recycling that every marina would buy trash can holders made from recycled boats as part of their support for a solution to handling the recycled boat problem. This is the new maritime industry I'm talking about, and it is addressing a need. I've heard from marinas and boatyards that in January and February every year, most of their workers are laid off because there isn't enough work to get them through the winter. If we instead told each, we put out there to the Rhode Island Marine Trades Association, how would you like to license boat dismantling operations and develop a code of conduct? The Europeans have already done it in terms of what should be done for worker safety, to make sure that the crew is wearing the right respirators, has the right safety tools, isn't creating an environmental problem. You don't want a lot of airborne fiberglass. It should be done in an enclosed area. I think there'd be a real interest in creating a new profit center for a boatyard in tearing boats apart during those cold weather months. It will take some organization. I know some of the boatyards are interested based on what they've told me, but we've got to do it in an organized way with some self-regulation to make sure people don't get killed and they don't create a new kind of environmental hazard. So the reason I think Rhode Island is the best place to start is, as I said, we have not much time. We've got about 20 years before our existing landfill is closed. This is becoming an embarrassing problem with boats literally piling up in boatyards around the state. Evan figures that we're actually need to scrap about a little over 1,000 boats a year. 16% of all Rhode Island households own a boat. That's one of the highest per capita boat registration numbers in the country. So Florida has many more boats, Peter, but on a per capita basis, with a population of under 1 million people, we own a lot of boats in this state. And because we have such little space to put the debris, the problem is a bit more pressing here. So what can we do for precedent? Lawyers like me like precedent. Other examples for how we could start something. The new mattress recycling council. What's another big bulky product that has lots of stuff in it that isn't very valuable? Your mattress. The national mattress industry, there is such a thing, formed the Mattress Recycling Council, and state by state, Rhode Island is now the third state after Connecticut and California to have adopted a mattress recycling statute in which everyone who buys a mattress effective just a couple of weeks ago pays an extra $10 when they buy a mattress so that a fund is created that can later be used to support a mattress recycling facility in each state. Something like that done nationally, perhaps done by our National Marine Manufacturers Association, with model legislation that could be adopted state by state. I'm hereby volunteering Rhode Island to go first, because this follows the model that we're already used to with, for example, the battery you buy for your car. You typically pay $10 more for your car battery that goes into a recycling fund. When you buy tires for your car, you might not realize it, but there's a 50-cent per tire recycling charge when you buy your new tires, so that there is a fund available to help finance carting those old tires away to be ground up to be used in road surfaces. So there is precedent for how to make this work. The challenge, the problem keeps getting bigger, and no one's willing to go first. No one's willing to buy the fiberglass grinding machine until they can be assured that boats will be brought to them. And by the way, No one wants to grind up a lot of fiberglass without knowing that someone over here is willing to turn it into insulation or to lawn furniture or something. So there's the public is uneasy, the boatyards are uneasy, people are afraid to make the investment. So it turns out this isn't a technical problem. This is a political problem, it's a social problem, it's a legal problem, it's a public finance problem, on top of being a looming solid waste management problem. And that's why nobody's done anything about this so far. So our effort is going to be chipping away at each one of these problem areas to make sure that there are answers to the question of, yes, there is precedent for how to do this. Yes, there are technical places to reuse this recyclate if we can get, for example, the insulation industry involved in this in a big way. But it's not going to happen next year. We're going to be working on this for a while, I think, to make this happen. But if we don't get serious about it now, it will never get done. So I ask for your input, your cooperation, and assistance as we go forward, because I'd really like to see this one done while I'm still Sea Grant Director. All right, thank you very much.